Yeah, he just asked for the use of our small conference room for today and tomorrow for a series of meetings that he's going to have with a whole bunch of people. And so I'll be with him briefly at 11:30 or so, and he may want to meet with various and sundry other folks in the county, I'm sure, not in the county government.
Calling in on Tuesday.
Yep, and you're going to give us a call?
I'm going to give you a call.
Okay.
Probably be 5 till or so. Get that all together, and then would you like me to use your stamps on documents?
Thanks for reminding your guests to leave, please.
And I may ask you to give it tomorrow on the record.
And just so you all know, Commissioner-elect Ozias did email on Friday saying he's not going to be able to go to.
Yeah.
Really appreciated the invite, but he's not going to be able to get away.
He just, he told me Thursday evening when we were over at Summit.
Oh, okay.
He just lost his number two, somebody, some doctor told him at first that I have some interesting wind-up operations to get.
The Minnesota Regional Transportation Planning Organization, I have some documents here, Commissioner. Are you planning to go?
Okay.
Okay, the 23rd.
I had a note, Minnesota Development Organization, they're meeting December 3rd, and that's also a Olympic Area Agency on Aging meeting in Shelton. And I don't know if you're going to try to do both.
No.
You catch the other on your way into town?
I don't think I can, because I got to make the run from Shelton to Swim.
Mm-hmm.
So I think I'll try to call in.
You know what? That reminds me. I was invited to come in person to that 03A thing, so I can take that.
Yeah.
And you can do the EBD or whatever. I never can remember exactly what the name of the thing is.
I can't either.
I was calling the old RC and
yeah.
Well, that works great.
Yeah. So I'll do 03A.
You know, we might want to note, just for people who are curious, that the courthouse is also closed on the 27th.
Yeah. And on the 03A, I noticed that the Association of Washington Association of the Commissions has a 04A. It's a position in a committee that is one step above these folks. So I was kind of curious about that at the conference this week.
Yeah, well, I had never even heard of that before. Until this question right now, either.
Yeah. Well, I've been rattling the cage on some issues with regard to providers, and especially out in the West. And, you know, you have to drive all the way to Port Angeles just to get fingerprinted.
Okay. The police department can't do it out there.
Correct. And then also you have to come in for training. You know, I get a PhD online, but I can't get a provider's certificate.
He's asking.
It's so private. Anyway. So I'm kind of stirring the pot on that.
Yeah, that's a good hot stir. It could be that this 04A is some kind of a state health care or elder services integration thing or something. I don't know what's going on down there anymore. It's just everybody's running around bumping into each other.
Yeah, item was also talked about in the combination of DHOs.
Yes.
And somehow that would affect these vehicles, yes?
Everything is in motion in Olympia in terms of health, human services. Who knows where it's all going to land? All the chips are flying around in the air. Who knows how they're all going to land, how they reconnect to each other. It's just confusing. Okay. Have you got our correspondence?
I have a letter from Peter Goldmark that's there, dated October 27th, that you all received about their report on the land that they manage and manage. So correspondence. And I have a couple of things. There is a proclamation tomorrow on the consent agenda. I don't know if you're comfortable signing it today.
Yeah.
Knowing that it's on the consent agenda for tomorrow. It's funky if they're stamped. So, and then the other one is,
pen there, I forgot my.
The certificate of appreciation for Ron Turner, and but I just have that on the Senate table. He did sign it already.
She needs it for.
Is that for the charter review?
Huh? No, she was on the CDM.
Yeah.
I think that's it for me.
All right, community development. Thanks, Trish. Agreement with Washington State Department of Ecology for Marine Resources Committee operations. Good morning.
This contract is the 15th or 16th or something that we have with the Department of Ecology to operate the Clown Marine Resources Committee. And so that helps us do a series of projects.
Good projects. Two-acre more, unless there are any questions, comments, further.
Okay. At some point, because they've got a bit of that, I think maybe they want to bring in sometime in the first quarter. That would have an update on that.
Yeah.
All of that. I know that great picture as well as how far they go out. So think about that. If you want. And keep them in probably 2 years to get them in.
That's right.
Okay.
To the department where the governor's salary recovery office said that
contracts are coming, and it will be retroactive back to July 1st, which they've done in previous years as well.
So did that impact you on your payments, cash flow, to continue the program while the state was sorting things out?
I think it only impacted us most recently because we were trying to keep our expenditures down to just staffing and not doing additional contracts. So it's been fine. We did a progress report. We did say that if the legislature was going to be late in the future, that it would be better to do what they did in 2013. In 2013, they amended and extended our existing contract because we usually have a little bit of rainy day funding left over. So I have communicated that that would have been more helpful to the county.
And with the retro, technically, we can go back and bill for any legitimate expenditures we've had since then.
Yes. Reserves.
Right.
Yes. The cash flow.
It's a lot cleaner if RCO just does a contract extension. You know, they can legally spend money, the appropriations made, governor signed, and all that kind of stuff. But, you know, it just takes, because we're at risk otherwise, but we are.
You saw it.
I had actually shared documents of what happened in 2013 to try to spearhead that, but there was some staff changes. There's also a federal Omni circular that was a change in some requirements that took some more work from admin to figure out on both the state level and the local level, so that would be one too.
And offer the same thing in the community capital for maybe historical, some of the projects that have been completed, the projects we're working on, the projects we're hoping to work on. Update on what you're doing. The first quarter of the new year, you know, all this history now, you know, it's been a while. So. It's good work. And so money keeps coming in. We sign the contracts that periodically it's important to put together a presentation. If it's put together here, people are more aware of it.
I think that would be helpful. And I think that would be good. And one thing, just because it's the end of the fall chum run, I wanted to report, we get really good reports from Sherry Scalp with the Department of Fish and Wildlife, and they had about 6,500 summer chum that came back through Jimmy Come Lake. You know, the Jamestown Spalm Tribe, the Conservation District, a lot of partners have worked on habitat improvement there and rootstock supplementation over the last decade. And they really thought that that area's capacity was maybe 3,000, 4,000 fish. So they had 6,500 back, and that was a stock that was down to 7 fish when you all and the partners started working on that. So that's a huge success. Salmon Creek, nearby Salmon Creek, which our partner, the Hickory County Coordinating Council, has worked on with all their many partners, the North Olympic Salmon Coalition and others this year, their returns were the highest ever in 40 years. And they had 6,800 summer chum that came back. So those are some of the success stories that we want to do a better job of sharing.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
If you get an update on the culverts, I know that's a massive project, but I worked on that when I was with Rainier, and I'm also interested in the work that you recommend to manage siltation.
Okay.
And there are a lot of simple things you can do, but on a large landscape, it is something you have to kind of look at. Thank you.
Some more funding and take care of some of those high priority culverts that need repairs.
you know, one of the things we found at Rainier was after installed a lot of water culverts, after a storm event, that we just had maintenance drop dramatically. And we did it. Yeah, we did it for fish, but what we found was in the high flow of the unit, all water was passing instead of pinching up areas.
Okay.
You guys do mostly the box style? Your culvert replacement, did you go with more of the box style?
A number of different designs on a big one. We actually sometimes would use an arch with concrete. And then we actually started making our own miniature bridges. They're only about 15 foot, which you can just drop them into place and they'd stay put. And it was actually cheaper than like an 8-foot one.
Stay tuned, there are good things happening with the river bridge. Probably be completed by the end of the year, and there'll probably be a vendor cleaning up there, and also the wire. That was a large cap piece of acquisition through the local land trust on the street along the river. So, yeah, partners and everybody working well together, and good things are happening.
I know in your leadership, that's continued, so I appreciate that. Good job over the years. It's part of the whole discussion.
We try, we've got a lot of good partners, so yeah, thank you.
Okay, this will come back to us on the 24th.
How many years are you going to do that?
Approaching nine.
Really?
Yes, serious. It's like yesterday, huh? Yeah.
Thanks, Cheryl.
You're welcome, thank you.
Notice of hearing on a proposed amendment to Clallam County Code, Title 31, comprehensive plan map of 33 zoning, in response to an application from Clallam County Parks Parent Facilities Department for a reason. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning. So the applicant, Clallam County Parks Affairs and Facilities Department, is requesting a rezone for comprehensive plan zoning amendment for two parcels totaling 40 acres from the presently zoned rural low to parks and recreation, and that's exhibit 14 in the packet. And on October 7th, the Planning Commission reviewed this rezone request. Staff presented a report covering the six criteria or required showing for an amendment, of which the Planning Commission found to be compliant with the comp plan and the development. Planning Commission took testimony from one nearby landowner, after which the applicant and staff attempted to address its concerns. Rezone request passed 6-1 with 0 abstentions, and the Planning Commission forwards a positive recommendation. The subject property is located east of Swim off the Old Green Highway. It's accessed from Thompson Road, which is County Road. Currently, the land is undeveloped and zoned rural low along with the surrounding properties. And if approved, this proposed rezone will allow the Department of Parks, Fair, and Facilities to construct an 18-hole disc golf course on the northern 20 acres, the southern 20 acres where Mans is. And then just a little history of the property. The 40 acres was originally owned by Clallam County Roads Department, and in 2004 it was used as a materials depository for the debris generated by an estuary restoration project on the Jean Camilla Creek. In April 2013, the northern 20 acres was transferred to the Parks Department, and then this past September, the southern 20 acres was transferred. And tomorrow, DC staff will be present for the call for hearing for the December 8th.
Good. Questions?
Yes.
This golf thing has had a long history. Questions, comments, 4A for tomorrow.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks very much. And actually, if we could make a change to that, I'm sorry, I didn't catch it.
town board, comma, U.S. Forest Service, comma, is appointed as representative of environmental groups.
Okay.
And spoke to the head of Forest Service and Forks, and his recommendations, this is U.S. Forest Service. She's part of a group, it's ethics.
Yeah, she's not a board member. I wonder about that.
And that was a really catchy to the Forest Service employee. Right. And I apologize, I should have caught that.
Well, you know, I did see it, and I asked Cindy about it. I said, and she just said, well, no, it's just identifying that she's with the Forest Service, but she's been selected as representative environmental group. Well, okay. And then, you know, we had one of our speakers, yeah, got all fired up and asked about it, and nobody made a comment, so I thought, well, everybody knows more about it than I do. So I'll just,
maybe you could why help those explain that. I guess it was a little confusing.
Yeah, so I don't know what it takes to reprocess, but it was deemed and all that, but he has the Forest Service powers.
Yeah, we could just bring the resolution back and just make a small, more or less pen and ink change, just to remove the U.S. Forest Service from the resolution. It's just simply a board.
Why don't we wait until we see if we can get a separate slot filled?
We can do
it. We're not waiting for one more. We're recruiting, so we're going to do it twice.
Yeah.
Okay. I can talk to Cindy about doing that. Bring it back when we have the other position.
We're recruiting for one more position.
We are. The Forest Coalition representative.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Anything else?
I just wanted to know what your advice would be now that we've dissolved the RID. Just right.
Yes.
The next step that takes place in that process, is it the case that our next course of action is to review those right of ways and then acquire that as a county road?
To me, the next process that I believe we're under is we're waiting for the road department and their attorney to bring back a revision in the RID policy. I thought that was our next step. And then that leaves then all options available on the table for determining what's going to be done next with that particular property. But that's what I thought. And so I know that they're working on it. Remember we talked about they have the Spokane model that they're, but I don't know, it's up to you guys. That's where I thought we were. We're waiting for that to occur.
My impression is we're now on kind of two parallel tracks. The RID's going. So we're gonna revise the RID policy.
Yes.
And then there's an item on the unfunded side of the TIP for this road. So now we can, you know, that's a county road project in waiting, we'll say.
I thought that came off. I thought that.
It was on the TIP that I saw the other day.
It's just unfunded.
So it's unfunded, and we can figure out how we're going to fund it and work with DNR. That's their.
Maybe the district commissioner wants to work with the road department to figure out how to get it funded. You could work with the road department. I had no problem if you could go out and you guys can figure out how to get that funded.
Sure.
So it's kind of your district, your road. You don't have funding for it in the budget now, but it doesn't mean the property is
Can't
be funded, so we can do both.
Yeah, my takeaway, what was in my mind, was we're kind of working on two tracks. One for the RID policy, the other one was
really the scope of the work, too, because the person feels more than just the RID is going to cover it.
Absolutely.
It's your road in your district, and you want to work with the local government to figure out the scope of work and fund it.
And so then, like, legally or procedurally, what is the action that occurs that says, all right, this is now a county road?
And so to buy it or
declaration of?
Yeah, there is a resolution of intent to accept it.
Okay.
Well, there's that process too. So, yeah, it's a little bit, but kind of is.
And there's like, what, 33 or 34 owners of that road? Or they each have to give us their section of it?
Yeah.
Or sell it to us? Joe has actually letters of intent from all of those people, some saying they would donate it, some saying no, they would sell it.
Yeah.
But that's several years ago.
Yeah, so it's just.
I'm comfortable with the district commission working with the road department. That's one of the next steps.
Okay, let me do that. I'll keep the ball on.
Thanks.
And then, I didn't have enough to do this week, so I put together a bunch of notes. On the policies.
We're gonna see how things.
Yeah, really. I was gonna walk away.
Wish I had.
I took a note a couple of weeks ago with regard to the policies that we've got that support the treasurer. And there's two of them that are interested in, Jim. One of them says that, what's the committee that's,
Finance.
Finance committee. Okay, so the issue is that there's a policy we have that states the, finance committee can take a look at financial policies.
Yeah.
And what I'd like us to consider is to, change that policy, it's actually the second sentence, it'll be like a two-sentence policy, by dropping that reference to, financial policy. And here's my logic, you know, that I believe the treasurer's got a pretty admirable goal right now. She believes that, she'll be the first treasurer in a long time to have not lost money. And that's why she's staying focused on the basics. And so I'd like to support her with that. And we've got a couple of things that are kind of backlogged, that I'd like the commissioners to be able to work on. And I suggest that we revise that policy by removing that committee from the process of financial policy review and development. The second one, Jim, I wasn't able to find it. I'm wondering if you could help us by taking a look at policies that the Treasury Department follows that identify what kind of financial instruments they can invest in. And I thought about this one, T-bills. You know, I mean, there's a lot of concern about how they invest their money over there. And I've heard the term used, return of capital, not return on capital. They just don't want to lose money. But I believe that they should be able to buy T-bills. And in fact, if a T-bill goes sour, we've got bigger problems than our return of capital. So that's an instrument that I'd like us to be able to look at. So could you find that?
Sure.
Policy, so sure, maybe like at the Monday work session.
We have two. We have the reference within Financial Policy 500 that talks about what the investment committee does. And then we have a separate investment policy.
Okay.
It's its own policy that talks about the treasurer. And so 500 is the one you found that has the calls it a finance policy instead of, or finance committee, instead of an investment committee. And then there's a separate investment committee policy that talks about what they can use. I don't remember the number right now, but I've got copies of it.
That better be good, because you know, we've got a couple of other organizations that, Palm Transit, which I think is very well run financially, and also the pool. And I have forwarded the treasury to those financial reports in the past. I just kind of think, why can't we do it? And if there's a reason we can't, that's fine.
Yeah, we talked a little bit during our budget discussions about our investment policy maybe being a little bit tighter than state law. And so if we might want to consider conforming it to state law. Then the treasurer, of course, may have discretion to do what treasurer feels best as far as the instruments which she uses to invest. But it won't necessarily artificially constrain it. If the treasurer wants to do something that right now our policy doesn't allow, what state law does, then you know that takes that set of restraints or constraints, I should say, off. But within that policy, the treasurer does what the treasurer feels necessary as far as doing safe investments, guarding against loss, all that kind of thing. That's just fine.
Well, from my perspective, I believe is totally 100% completely in your lane to amend policy 500 that drops the section of saying that the investment committee or the finance committee will, you know, advise the commissioners on budget. That's totally yours. But I don't believe the investment policy change is completely in your lane. I think that under the state RCW is supposed to go to the investment committee, we just named it finance committee. The RCW calls it investment committee and makes a recommendation. Yes, you do change policy, but you have to get first, I believe, the recommendation from the investment committee, which is made up of the treasurer, the auditor, and the chair of the board.
That is absolutely.
I think you have to do that step first. But the other one you don't have.
Right. We should request the finance committee, as we jump in, to take a round turn on the investment policy.
Yeah.
And if they deem necessary to make whatever recommendations to us, we'll take that and change policy. The other thing that we talked about was just a fairly small tweak to our reserve policy. Other than general fund budget items,
yes,
to require the 10% only as it relates to the salary component of that line item, that might take a little bit of constraint off of us.
Although I did look at it, I came back and made that report to you, and I looked at it, and we can certainly do that, but it was of no consequence, as it turned out, in any of the ones that we had problems with. They needed the money for cash flow, which was far in excess of the 10% of the total budget. And so it ended up being a much ado about nothing. We thought it might make a difference, it didn't. But I can certainly bring that change back, but it turns out the cash flow on those two that we were concerned about was a far greater concern than was the, it turns out they needed bigger than a 10%,
right.
Both of them.
Well, that's fine. The only other thing I remember of any consequence, and this is not policy, it's just how you configure your budget, was to take the HHS operations line.
Yes.
And put it into the general fund, I think.
Right. And we committed in our last budget meeting, or the last one, that we were going to work with IVA and do it over next year. And try and get it done by October with the federal law.
September 30th.
Right. Right. That's what we decided to do.
So we did back in 2017.
Yes. Yes. Principally. Exactly. Because we need to start applying for things in July and August. Effective October 1 in the new mode. And so we're on track to do that. And that's included in the draft budget that we'll go to hearing tomorrow. It's already posted on the website.
Well, if there's consensus, Jim, let's just kind of the next step here is to ask the Finance Committee to take out the investment policy and make any changes.
Not yet.
Because they didn't have the third one.
Yeah,
I haven't seen one scheduled yet.
So, either in December or January, which should be not in the next.
But I can certainly bring back a draft change of policy 500, which would change that one sentence if you wish, if the board desires it.
Well, and if you could share with the Finance Committee, I'll support a change to policy on how we make our investments if I see two things. One, plans will stay up. And I do believe what we have now is around an overreaction to something in the past that's never been changed. And two, the decision rests with the treasurer. I don't want to see any kind of taking that authority from the treasurer.
No, of course not.
So please let them understand that. The objective was to lay down options.
Okay.
Yeah, the objective in my mind is to provide
And I got an email this weekend dealing with electronic mortgage registration companies. It's a lawsuit in Seattle. Do you see any of them? I'll forward that one to you, John. That's an issue here in Palm County. Maybe you can advise us. It has to do with the way mortgage defaults were handled. And so after the person couldn't meet the payments and they don't make the account for auction, there's a challenge to the process. And now the return is based on foreclosures.
I do know there was something, maybe that's what it was about. There was a lot of discussion, and maybe this was the result of it. There's a lot of discussion that banks who sold their deeds of trust into the secondary market, Fannie and Freddie, and retained the servicing, have been doing all the foreclosures without actually having the note and deed of trust, the actual original document, to present at the foreclosure, and that was a violation of the five states' real estate law, ours being one of them, the five western states, we have a combined real estate law, and that a number of companies, a number of people were challenging, saying, hey, I want to see my note, and nobody could find it, because it got sold so many times before it was finally put in a package. And I don't know if that's what this was, but I do know that there was a challenge that if you didn't have the actual original document, you couldn't foreclose it. And people were trying, remember that? People were trying to successfully foreclosing without the original document, just based on the copy. And so maybe that's what that turned out to be, and that through all the paperwork.
Email was actually Port Hall that sent it to me, and it's a lawsuit in Kane County, but it caused me to wonder.
Yeah, it's a banking law issue. It's not the county's issue, but it's a banking law issue that, you know, and I was, and the only reason it piqued my interest is because I was in at the very beginning of First Federal's foray into the secondary market, just as I was leaving there. We'd been purchasing in the secondary market, but it never sold into it. And so I was doing some of the research as, you know, changing the operations, and they started doing it after I left. And that was one of the laws that our state, along with California, Oregon, Idaho, and Alaska, required that in order to do a foreclosure, you had to have the original. And the secondary market required you to send the original off, and yet you retained this. So that seemed to be incongruent with our laws. That was just one of the things I pointed out as I was going out the door. And so that was why it kind of piqued my interest, you know, when I started reading about these people challenging that they get sold and repackaged in somewhere in that pile, nobody knows what happened to the original.
Yeah, that's
no deed of trust.
That's that probably is what this.
Larger issue.
Yeah,
the national issue, really.
Yeah. Well, five states that have that law, the real estate law, the five western states combined together in a common real estate law. And in 1982, changed from, we didn't used to allow deeds of trust in our state. And that's why it used to have to be a mortgage. In 1982, that changed. And it had to change in all five states at the same time. It was just that I was there at the beginning of that.
And we had a really good fundraiser for Chamber of Commerce. Lots of people showed up, and a couple of constituents approached me on a couple of issues. One is they're making progress on the noxious weed manual. And my question is, when we finish that, last time we talked about it, was let us look at a manual. And so they're making progress on that. The question is, once that is completed, and I expect that in the next month, maybe two, do we have to take that document to a public hearing? Because we already have a public hearing.
It's not our policy. It's just a procedure that, it depends on how you want to pass
that. It depends on what it says.
Yeah,
it
does.
We still have a policy out there.
Yeah, if it's going to be a county policy, we would have to sign it.
Right.
The way we left it after the hearing, as I recall, correct me if I'm not remembering, is that we were going to have the says how you do it together side by side, so that we can say, do we want to do this or don't we?
And if it's just a procedures manual, like the road department has, a lot of departments, sheriff's office has it, all kinds of people have procedures manuals, those aren't hours that require public hearing, but they do come for a presentation.
And I think we're kind of promising rainbow back.
Right, they do require a presentation, is what I'm saying, but if we make it a policy, then it's a full guarantee.
So I think one of the steps they're going to take is to have workshops in each of the three cities, and then what they want to do is record the comments that are made about whatever is the issue, and then identify their response, and then when they bring the document to the commissioners, they'll say, we conducted these meetings, here are the issues that were identified by the public, here's our response to them, and here's our recommendation.
I'll take it on myself to get in contact with Mark Zias, because I know he testified against the ordinance back when we were considering that. And I'll just make sure he knows, you know, where we're at currently, and see where his comfort zone lies about the process. If we were to get that done before the term of the year, would he want to revisit that, or wouldn't he, or would he want to delay it until the beginning of the year?
If we don't do the notice by next week, we're already too late to do it this year, because of the
public hearings in the district.
Yeah, so there's no chance to do it this year before the year's out, because of our required notices. Next week's the last week to get notices. That's going to happen. This year, the hearings is going to happen.
Yes, I'm kind of checking out for that.
So I'll go ahead and just bring Mark up speed on this issue. He and I want to get together. We just haven't done so yet. I match calendars and all that. So that'll be on the agenda to talk with them about this.
There's some other projects.
Yeah, he and I went to the Sunland meeting on the swim dungeness question. Hammered out for a long time. It was a good meeting. I think everybody left in a pretty good state of mind.
On Wednesday, I know
that's one thing that's going to kind of need to change, is I think commissioners are going to have to be more advocates for road projects. In the past, it was just kind of, the process was just kind of driven through the road department, and we all kind of defer to that process. But I think now it's important that commissioners are going to need to go to the meetings in their district, figure out what the constituents for road projects, and then they're going to come back here and kind of advocate. Look, this is a work project, and explain to the full board why. And so I hope that the road department kind of understands that they probably should use the same commissioners.
To the point that we might eventually contemplate having three different road districts.
I hope that you can work with Ross.
How would we fund
them? I'm not advocating that.
I think you should work with Ross as a supervisor. To expect more and more.
Oh, and it makes sense with voting only by district now.
Yeah, that's why they want to do it.
Close to a geographic third, you know, the west end obviously is going to have a ton more road miles. So, but anyway, some sort of trifurcated decision-making policy where we're, you know, as you say, Mike, where we're, you know, focusing by district on what our TIP is going to look like for the next 6 years.
Well, that's why I continue to raise my hand on the TIP discussions about the Discovery Trail funding. Because I went to the meeting that we had in Swim, you know, the roundabout, the safety, you know, there's some good issues.
Sure.
And I would expect those projects to pop up. And so, you know, I'm very flexible. That's a, you know, Discovery Trail's a long-term project. So if there's a short-term need, we should address it.
Well, I have another question, and I haven't done the math on this yet. I was kind of waiting until we got done with the budget, and now I'm pretty much done, so I was going to start working on this. Is that with the change into commissioners being elected only by their district, and like you're talking about now, and the possibility of wanting to separate monies into each district, monies come as a result of assessed value, not as a result of population.
That is correct.
And so I can tell you that I think it is going to be surprising how much the difference in the assessed value is going to be in each of the three districts in terms of road taxes. I'm just saying, in terms of road tax. We don't do road tax by district right now.
I know that.
But because we're going to be voting by district, and if you're suggesting it might be advantageous to also budget by district.
I think what's being said is the road department should expect a little more input from the district commissioner.
And it makes total sense.
And if that district commissioner is not an advocate for that road project, it may not just move along like it normally has. So just for them to incorporate upfront, hey, here's some projects coming to your district over the next 2 or 3 years, are you still comfortable? And let them maybe get the commissioner out there to look at it and take it. That's all I'm saying. That's the only thing, because I think with the road project, there's a choice between one project or another, and the district commissioner is not an advocate. I think the road project needs to realize.
And all that's true, right? I'm taking one more step. How long is it going to be before the citizens in the first district come to the first district commissioner and saying, hey, wait a minute, we're providing 2/3 of the road department funding through our taxes. We don't want you to spend our money. We want 2/3 of the money in our district. How long is that going to happen?
So much of their funding comes from state federal dollars. Well, most of our budget wants to come right for our people.
Maintenance.
I think their three road shops would be pretty equally staffed.
They are.
They're going to want to see is that all three get the plowing, the mowing, the trimming, the maintenance. So I don't want anybody to make this a big deal. So I just want the road department to be aware that it's not going to be uncommon for a commissioner to be at a neighborhood meeting years gone by that wasn't always given. You know, I think it's going to be more important.
And I'm down to three,
right?
So far. So
over the years, it makes a lot of sense to do that.
There can only be
one.
Yeah, there can only be one county commissioner.
And just so you know, he's gone until November 1st. He's taken an extended hunting trip.
So you need to work again in the new year.
Yeah.
I'll learn.
I'll do that.
There can only be one county budget. Nobody wants to see the budget modernized. That's it.
Okay, see, I thought that's what you were saying. You wanted to have three road districts with three sets of money.
That's not what I'm saying.
Okay, I misunderstood.
What I am saying is the political dynamic has changed in ways that we can't foresee right this minute. So that's going to be the conversation going forward, I think.
Well, another example, Jim, you should be getting an email in preparation for the December 1st tip, the last hearing that we're going to have on the tip. And it was an individual from the community that approached me with, you basically have these meetings, and I'd like to share an issue in this where Bear Creek intersects with one and one. And so it's a big safety problem. A couple of solutions, a couple of alternatives. One would be put your hand in the air for the county to consider it during the tip process for a plot lane, or have the state put in lines. At any rate, that's in our way. And as a result of the awareness we're creating with regard to public development. Thanks for the opportunity.
You bet. I gotta go get my wife out of the hospital here. So anything else? Not just a normal. We will adjourn this week's meeting. There will be two commissioners at the Crown Board of Transit in their meeting this afternoon. Reconvene under solo leadership. There will be two commissioners on the phone, one in attendance tomorrow at 10 o'clock for the whole session.
stamps on documents.
Thanks for reminding your guests to leave, please.
And I may ask you to give them all on record.
And just so you all know, Commissioner-elect Ozias did email on Friday saying he's not going to be able to go to, really appreciate the invite, but he's not going to be able to get away.
He just, he told me Thursday evening when we were over at Summit, he just lost his number two, somebody, some doctor still came up for us. I have some interesting wind-up operations to get, other than two people hired to go there, so. But it means it bores.
The Peninsula Regional Transportation Planning Organization, I have some documents here, Commissioner. Okay, are you planning to go?
I'll get the 23rd and I will have the canvassing part.
Correct.
Have you seen anything else that? Commissioner Page, I had a note, Peninsula Development Organization, they're meeting December 3rd, and that's also Olympic Area Agency on Aging meeting in Shelton. And I don't know if you're going to try to do both?
No.
Catch the other on your way into town?
I don't think I can, because it means I got to make the run from Shelton to Swim. So I think I'll try to call in.
You know what? That reminds me, I was invited to come in person to that O3A thing, so I can take that.
Thank you.
And you can do the EBD or whatever. I never can remember exactly what the name of the thing is.
I can't either.
Call it the over scene, dude.
Yeah.
Well, that works great.
Yeah. So I'll do the O3A show.
You know, we might want to note, just for people who are curious, that the courthouse is also closed on the 27th.
And on the O3A, I noticed that the Association of Washington Association of Commissions has a 04A. It's a position in committee. It is one step above these folks at the state level. So I was kind of curious about that at the conference this week.
Yeah, well, I had never even heard of that before. Until I was mentioned right now either.
Well, I've been rattling the cage on some issues with regard to providers, and especially out in the West. And, you know, you have to drive all the way to Port Angeles just to get fingerprinted. Okay?
The police department can't do it out there.
Correct. Yeah. And then also you have to come in for training. You know, I get a PhD online, but I can't get a provider's certificate.
So it's a lot of money for a consumer police department to process that.
Really?
It doesn't take the people for background checks for the state over that.
He's asking.
Oh, I don't know.
Yeah, we have to take the forms of police.
It's so vital.
Meeting and our work session as usual with calendar and correspondence.
We have transit today, and then I understand Matthew Randazzo was in town this afternoon from 1:30 to 3:30.
Yeah, he just asked for the use of our small conference room for today and tomorrow for a series of meetings that he's going to have with a whole bunch of people. And so I'll be with him briefly at 11:30 or so. He may want to meet with various and sundry other folks in the county, I'm sure, not in the county government.
Calling in on Tuesday.
Yep.
And you're going to give us a call?
I'm going to give you a call.
Okay.
Probably be 5 till or so. Get that all together, and then would you like me to use?
Anyway. So I'm kind of stirring the pot on that.
Yeah, that's a good pot stir. It could be that this O4A is some kind of a state healthcare, elder services integration thing or something. I don't know what's going on down there. It's just everybody running off into each other.
Yeah, and it was also talked about in a combination of DHOs.
Yes.
And somehow that will affect these vehicles.
Yes.